John Maynard Keynes has been one of the most influential and famous economists in the whole world. Learning modern-day economics is pretty difficult without understanding aggregate demand and aggregate supply, which further will help you understand the Keynesian theory of employment. This video is going to be a foundation to learning macroeconomics ahead in your life. So stay attentive, because when all this starts to make sense to you, you're going to find it really very interesting. Welcome to the Sagar channel, my friends. Let's study a few determinants of aggregates. Let's start by understanding what aggregate demand is. Now, the way Google defines it is that it is the total demand for all goods and services within a particular market. However easy, this definition does not help us understand how demand is measured. Hence, in any standard book, you'll find aggregate demand defined as this. Aggregate demand refers to the amount of sales proceeds which the entrepreneur actually expects from the sale of output produced at a given level of employment during the year. This is actually pretty easy to understand, so you need not worry. However, you need to know what demand actually means. Do watch out the previous video on demand analysis to understand demand. Demand is the combination of three things: the desire for an asset, the willingness for an asset, and the ability to pay for it. Here, desire and willingness are things which are intangible. Hence, to measure them is not possible. However, our ability to pay is something that we can measure. Think of it. When you go out to buy a t-shirt, your demand for the t-shirt heavily depends on your ability to pay for it. If you pay 1000 rupee and purchase it, then you demanded it. And if you didn't pay and you did not purchase it, then you did not demand it. Which means your demand can be measured with the help of the expenditure done by you. Similarly, a country's demand can be measured with the help of the expenditure done by the country, which includes all the residents of the country. Hence, we call such demand as aggregate demand. Now, think of this. Whatever expenditure you do is the revenue for the entrepreneur. Hence, your expenditure and the revenue that the entrepreneur earns are one and the same. Let us call the revenue that the entrepreneur earns as the sales proceeds. So this way, we can say that the sales proceeds is a good way of measuring demand. And that is exactly what our definition tells us, that aggregate demand is nothing but the sales proceeds or the revenue that the entrepreneur expects from the sale of output that he or she has produced at a certain level of employment in a particular year. I hope I made the definition simple enough for you to understand. Thinking of aggregate demand this way helps because then we can express aggregate demand in a very tiny expression. Somewhat like this. AD is equal to C plus I plus G plus X minus M. Let me ask you a question. From what sources will entrepreneurs of a country expect to receive revenue? From the expenditure that people do for consumption? From the expenditure that people do on investments? The expenditure that government does for welfare of the people? And last but not the least, from the exports that businesses have done to foreign countries. We will analyze each of them one by one. Let's begin with consumption expenditure first. Any expenditure that you do in your day-to-day life directly, like purchasing clothes or buying a car or receiving health services, etc., are consumption expenditure. Remember that all the expenditure that's done by you for the consumption of goods or services is called as consumption expenditure. When can you spend on consuming something? Only when you have certain income, which means that consumption expenditure is dependent upon income. The more income you have, the more your consumption will be. You can also draw this on a graph. Notice how your consumption is increasing with increase in income. Such consumption expenditure, which is dependent upon income that you earn, is called as induced consumption expenditure. But hey, you don't spend your entire income. You just spend a part of it. Rest, you save. Say for example, your income is rupee 100 and you spend only rupee 60. So, you save rupee 40. Out of 100, 60 is the amount you consume. That means you consume 0.6 rupee of every 1 rupee you earn. This 0.6 is called as the marginal propensity to consume, which is abbreviated as MPC a lot of time. The slope of this line is the MPC. The slope shows us that for every 1 rupee of income you have earned, 0.6 rupee is consumed. And you save rupee 40 out of rupee 100. So you save 0.4 rupee of every rupee you earn. So 0.4 is called as marginal propensity to save, or MPS. Now let me ask you a question. Say you don't earn any form of income for next 100 days and you don't even have any savings. Will that mean that you won't have any consumption for these many days? No, right? This is because there is some form of consumption which is independent of income that you earn. You might see beggars or poor people consuming food irrespective of the shortage of money. Such consumption which is independent of income, or in other words, consumption done even when your income is zero, is called as autonomous consumption. Hence, your consumption curve will actually look somewhat like this. This part is the autonomous consumption, the consumption that the country does even when the income is zero. The curve showcases induced consumption, and the slope is marginal propensity to consume. In an algebraic form, you can write the consumption equation as C is equal to A plus CY, where A equals autonomous consumption, Y equals income, and C is the marginal propensity to consume. Friends, if you're listening to all of this for the first time, it will be a little difficult for you to grasp it all at once. Feel free to pause whenever necessary and watch it once more. It'll all make sense. Another component of aggregate demand is investment. In simple words, if I were to explain you what investment is, then you can say that any addition made to a country's asset that helps in generating even more money can be termed as investment. In difficult words, any addition to a country's physical stock of capital like plants or machinery, factory building, etc., as well as finished and semi-finished goods which help in capital formation is called as investment. Both of them mean the same. Now similar to consumption, even investment can be induced as well as autonomous. We all know that a businessman will only make an investment in a business if he or she feels that the investment is going to give him or her profit. So, investment firstly depends on the expectation of profit. Secondly, other factors like availability of loan, level of income, supply of money, etc. are all the things that influence investment. When investment is made after looking at all these things, we call it induced investment. Whereas, when investment is made not looking at profits or any other factor mentioned above, it's autonomous investment. Now, you might say, only a fool would make an investment by outlooking profit. Hey, don't go so hard. There are certain government organizations that have to make investments in energy projects, irrigation projects, electricity generation plant, etc. for the development of the country. These are not for profit as well as do not depend on all the factors that are mentioned above. Hence, they are autonomous. Say that you have rupees 10 lakh or a million rupee to invest in a mobile sales business. And you are pretty keen in investing in the business because you expect it to give you 10% return. But if I come to you and tell you that bro, you know what? Bank of Maharashtra is ready to give you 10% return as well. Why are you taking the risk of investing into a business when a bank is giving you the same amount of return for just keeping the money with it? Plus, your money will be safe. You see the point. A person will only wish to invest into a business if the return that he's expecting from conducting that business is more than the return that the bank outside is willing to pay. Say you expect 20% return from the business and the bank is giving you only 10%. You will surely go ahead with the business. If it is the other way around, you won't. This 20% over here is called as the marginal efficiency of capital, whereas this 10% is the rate of interest that the bank is willing to pay. Marginal efficiency of capital and investment have direct relationship. This means the more returns he expects from the business, the more investments he'll make. That's common sense. On the other hand, investment and interest rate have an inverse relationship. This is because as the rate of interest goes up, people prefer keeping money in their bank accounts and earn risk-free returns than taking a risk of investing in a business. The third component of aggregate demand is government expenditure. Like all other residents of the country, government too purchases a lot of things from entrepreneurs. Therefore, government expenditure plays an important role in determining aggregate demand. Like normal residents, government too has consumption expenditure and investment expenditure. All the expenditure that helps for direct consumption like electricity, water, parks, police services, etc. is government's consumption expenditure. Expenditure done on projects that add to country's capital assets like transport, communication, irrigation, education, banking, etc. is investment expenditure. And last but not the least, net earnings, that is exports minus imports, is another component of aggregate demand. We all know that all the goods that we sell to the foreign countries are exports, and all that we purchase from them is imports. If say, entrepreneurs expect to export goods worth 1000 and import goods worth 800, then they expect net earnings worth 200. This 200 is also the sales proceeds that the entrepreneurs expect. Hence, it's a part of aggregate demand. I hope the video was simple enough to make you all understand aggregate demand. Forgive the length of the video, but I had to make the video a little big to simplify the concepts. In the next video, we'll learn aggregate supply. If you find this video useful, do share it with your friends. Bless me with your good comments in the comment section. This will motivate me to keep making more videos. And don't forget to subscribe. Until then, adios. Hasta la vista.